Okay. So, welcome again to the talk on why infinite dimensional geometry. So this is the first lecture in this MAT 331 topics and analysis course, which is running this semester at the University of Bergen and has been also made a gathering based course by the Trond Moen Stiftelse. So we want to acknowledge the support here. And so what are we going to do in this lecture? So the plan for today is basically what is and why should we care about infinite dimensional geometry, because the title infinite dimensional geometry probably doesn't betray what we are going to do in this lecture. So I want to give a few views on what is the difference between the infinite dimensional geometry I want to discuss and the finite dimensional geometry, which at least some of you are familiar with. And finally, so what will be treated in this lecture. And as I said, in case you don't know the objects which I'm going to talk about, which at least for a lot of the students which I've talked to before is true. So this is, as I said, a feature and not a bug. So we will define all these objects rigorously in the lecture, and we will sort of provide the details for all the hand waving I'm doing now. So the purpose of this lecture is more to give an impression of what you can do or what you should be able to understand once we are more or less done with the lecture. That's sort of the plan for today. So it's more like a show of nice things which are true or which you can prove using infinite dimensional geometry. Okay, and since I'm saying infinite dimensional geometry all the time, so I mean a very special kind of geometry. I mean, there are lots of infinite dimensional geometries. So I actually mean differential geometry. So we want to use some sort of calculus, differential or integral calculus, and multilinear algebra to study problems in geometry. And since it's infinite dimensional, we will be doing it on infinite dimensional spaces and manifolds. So that's a sort of the special focus of this course. And as you might know, there are many flavors of infinite dimensional, or no, not only infinite, but of differential geometries. For example, you can do Riemannian symplectic contact geometry, can study Lie groups, and many, many more things. So obviously, all of this would fit into a course on infinite dimensional geometry, but since we have only a finite amount of time, so I want to, in this course, to basically study two geometric situations, or two of these flavors. Namely, we will be looking mostly into Riemannian geometry on infinite dimensional spaces and into Lie groups. Okay, so there will be no symplectic or contact geometry in this course. Sorry for that if that's your cup of tea, but we'll be doing more Riemannian and Lie things. Okay. And now the core of this lecture will be, so why at all study infinite dimension geometry? And well, the cheap answer is always, if you're coming, say, from physics, or so I have some problems in quantum mechanics, or are interested in variational calculus, so some areas of mathematics lead naturally to problems which should be formulated on infinite dimensional spaces. A huge topic in the lecture will be spaces or manifolds of differentiable mappings. We'll get to that. But okay, so the why is this a cheap answer as to why you should care about infinite dimensional geometry? So the point is, you can say, well, I don't care about your strange infinite dimensional examples. So all I care about are finite dimensional problems, right? So this is already hard enough. So why should I bother myself with going to infinite dimensions where stuff might, or is conceivably harder than just on the finite dimensional realm? And so the idea is that I will want to present now some examples of finite dimensional problems which naturally lead to infinite dimensional structures and which can be tackled or solved using infinite dimensional techniques. So very often these infinite dimensional techniques will not be the only way to solve them, but a lot of times they provide a very elegant formulation for things which one thinks are finite dimensional. Okay. So let's have a look at an example of finite dimensional problems you might have, which can be formulated on infinite dimensional spaces. So the first example I would like to give is shape analysis. So from shapes to geometry. And okay, so what is a shape? So in this context, what do you mean by shape? That's an unparametrized curve in a vector space or a manifold. What do I mean by that? Usually, if you have a curve, then you can think of this as a smooth map. So this would be the parametrization of the image. And basically, what you want to study in shape analysis, you want to describe the image of the curve as your shape, but you're not really interested in which smooth mapping is realizing this shape. So you basically want to study, for example, in image recognition, you have contours. So here we have a picture from a paper by several people on stereo sensors for intersection driving, and the task is basically, so these sensors should scan some image they get from a camera, and so then you find some mathematical techniques to map what you have on the picture to some contours. So in this case here, the yellow contours basically should outline people crossing the street. And well, on one hand, if you have these contours, you want an algorithm to analyze the picture and say, well, okay, there are people, probably the car or whatever you're building there shouldn't drive over the intersection, because then we are running over people, so that's bad. Okay, and so basically, the methods of shape analysis I'm talking about are setting in once you have a set of contours. So we don't really care how you extract these contours from a picture you get. This would be another mathematical problem for which there are well-known methods. But say you have these contours, and as you might notice, so the picture is a little bit small, but there are these yellow contours. And there are also green contours of other stuff which is lying around in the picture, and which the algorithm probably wants to separate from the people running around there, right? So for example, there might be other objects standing around, and you have this green label here, or these green contours, and you want to distinguish between contours which belong to people, because they are probably relevant for you not to run them over, and other stuff. I mean, you probably also don't want to run over the other stuff, but at least say if it looks like a street sign or something, then it won't move. So you basically the algorithm can take some shortcuts. People are usually moving and are more dangerous than stationary objects. However, the question is, of course, so once you have all these contours, which you can think of a curve or the image of a curve, so of your shape, how do you distinguish between shapes? Yeah? So how do you teach a computer, or how do you set up the mathematical problem of distinguishing these closed planar curves from video footage or some pictures you have there? Okay, and one possibility, so this is from a paper by Peter Michaud and his collaborators, is well, actually they do transformation of these shapes, but the reason I'm showing this to you, you can see all these small crosses here, and so you have a contour. This upper one here should be the contour of a cat, in the upper left corner. That's a cat, and you basically think of this contour as something akin to a band of rubber. If you want to put it in a computer, and that's what these crosses are for, you take finitely many data points and then move them around. But when you want to formulate the problem as an infinite dimensional problem, you think of the whole contour as a band of rubber, which in principle in every point can be deformed as you want. And so what this picture from this paper by Michaud and collaborators is showcasing, basically they have in a way sort of a shortest way between these contours. So in the upper left corner you have this cat, and on the upper right corner this is probably some sort of dog or something like this, and the intermediate shapes are basically sampled from a curve of curves, where you are going from the shape of a cat to the shape of a dog in sort of the most efficient way. I'm very I'm very fishy here because I am talking about most efficient way. So what does that actually mean? Or so how do you do these transformations? But bear with me for a moment. We are getting there. Let me give you some other examples of what you might be interested in the shape analysis business. So long in the previous picture, we saw contours in a 2D image. So basically, all the curves we were studying were curves which take values in two-dimensional space. I mean, for example, these outlines here. But there might also be interesting applications where the underlying space where your shapes are living are not a two-dimensional space, but something more complicated. So for example, you might want to study curves on a sphere. So you have this three-dimensional sphere, and you have these the blue and the purple curve sitting on the sphere, and you want to measure in some way how far these two curves are from each other. And so the whole idea for this curve deformation business is, and this is what sort of is, the picture B is showing. You start with one curve, let's say the green one, and you try to deform it into the shape of the purple one in a most efficient way. So again, I'm not telling you what I mean by most efficient, so this will be part of the mathematical problem. But you basically can think of it, if you think of the curve as a rubber band, you can basically think of, you start with your rubber band in one configuration, and you just pull at it and or push at it and bend it so that it goes to the other configuration you want. So from the green one to the purple one. And then you measure in some way how costly that was, or how much effort you had to put into the deformation. And this gives you a measure of how far away these two shapes are. So the curves I've shown you so far were all closed curves. All right, so in the first picture, and also with the one with this outline of the cat. So what you can see in the picture labeled B, for example, the yellow curve is not closed, right? So there's a priori that it's not necessarily for these shapes to be closed. Of course, if you want to look at contours, then probably you want them to stay closed. But in principle, you can just do this with arbitrary curves. Okay, so I mean, this is now a toy example from curves living on spheres. Can you do some serious application where you want to have perhaps a little bit even more complicated space than the sphere? And so I have a nice toy example which was worked out by a PhD student and that was published in a joint paper. It's basically coming from motion capturing. So if you're doing motion capturing, then you have an actor or something which is running around in front of a camera and doing whatever motions you want. So he's wearing one of these suits you can see on the left-hand side, which has these white dots on them, which are tracked by the camera. And then this is all mapped to a 3D model, which you can see here in the middle. And basically what you think of this 3D model, so it's some sort of stick figure. And the stick figure has joints, and to describe the motion the human was doing with the stick figure, you just need to know how these joints are rotated, right? So you think of the limbs of the figure just as rods of some length, and they are joined at these blue balls you see there, and you just track what the rotation is doing. And if you've seen that, so rotations form a group, right? So you can just compose them. So if you want to describe this movement, you can just think of them. For every joint, we get a curve in the group of rotations, which describes at a certain time t what should the rotation be. Okay, and so why are you interested, or why could one be interested in this motion capturing data? So the typical problem with motion capturing data, I mean, you have your nice actor in front of the camera and you let him act something or let him walk somewhere, but It's often the case that these motion capturing data pieces are, or these motion capturing videos, they are relatively short because time is money. So you have to pay the actor. You don't want him to run around in front of the camera the whole day until you get all possible movements you might ever want or something like that. So you have perhaps a running animation, which shows the actor running perhaps for 5 seconds or something. Now, so the PhD student, Markus Eslitz-Bichler, who made the animation I'm going to show you, so he was basically studying algorithms to do the following. So if you have a 5 second piece of the animation, you might want to loop the animation. Say, for example, you want to make a computer game or some computer graphics where the running animation is longer than 5 seconds. What you don't want is discontinuities in the movement. So when you have your 5 second animation loop, so the actor starts somewhere, runs, and after the 5 seconds, so the body is not in the same position as when he started running, right? So humans are really bad in getting, you say, okay, start here. In 5 seconds, you are in exactly the same position as you were before. So nobody can really do that. And so you can develop some computer algorithms based on this shape analysis stuff to do exactly that. So let me just switch to the other computer for a moment. Wait a second. Yeah, so let's see that. Okay, so here we have a small movie. So I'm showing it to you first, and then we'll see what's happening. So so there will be basically two movies, and from left to right, this will be a whole time series. Yeah? So this is showing this is showing the movement. Okay, let's see. So just look at the upper one. So there's this motion capturing data where actor does some, okay, I don't know what that is in English, so he does some acrobatics, and we have it three times, so the original is just one of these red loops you get, so it stops exactly here, right? So this was the original motion capturing data, and so let me just run a few seconds more and look here at the foot area. So there you will see a discontinuity. So suddenly, so it's now in this position, and when it starts the next loop, basically, so the feet will jump a little bit to the left. So there's a discontinuity. So let's go see. Ah, there. Have you seen it? So it just jumps a tiny little bit to the left, and the whole configuration of the stick figure changes abruptly. So let me just run it again, and when the next time it does that, you will see it probably. So now it, yes, so there was another discontinuity. Okay, and so humans are very good in tracking these discontinuities. So if you want to have a continuous motion that looks very, very badly, if you just set them together, you can of course have somebody sitting there and just correcting everything so that it looks better, but then you need to pay somebody doing that. And so what the aim of this project with Elena Celedoni from Trondheim and Markus Eslitz-Bichler, so the PhD student or the former PhD student, was to develop an algorithm which just takes some motion capturing data and uses infinite dimension geometry to close the loop. So we have up here these discontinuities, and now let's if you take a look at the lower one where it says closed, so there are no jerks or discontinuities in the movement. So the figure is basically, well, one can of course discuss whether this is very natural how it moves, but at least there's no discontinuity where the figure has to jump from one configuration into another to just loop the animation. Okay, I mean, this is still a toy example, but it's a nice thing nevertheless. Okay, so let's see. Let me stop this here. Let's go back to the other one. Okay. Okay. Now let's go a little bit, after we've seen some nice pictures, let's go a little bit to the mathematical formulation. again, there's another picture. So long, we have seen it only for curves, but there's no, nobody stopping you to do it for an area or for some surface or something. So in principle, all these methods can be scaled to, instead of doing curves, you can also do it with a 2D shape or a 3D shape. And so, for example, with these surfaces, there are actually applications in medical imaging where you compare sort of your medical images to pictures of healthy and ill organs, for example. So there were some people who were doing this with liver cells, and then the system tells you whether it thinks there's something wrong with the liver, right? So there are some serious applications, not just sort of we want to do computer animation. Anyway, so it turns out that the setting is an infinite dimension manifold, and what you do is you take regular curves, so say regular meaning smooth here, and you quotient out the parametrization. So I haven't explained anything. What do I mean by infinite dimension manifold, right? So we're getting later to that. How can you think of this? Well, going back to this rubber band, right? So we were interested in the image, and how do you get an infinite dimensional manifold of rubber bands? Basically, you think of every point on your rubber band as a parameter. So you get infinitely many points, and this is a way of, or at least of justifying of why these shapes should form an infinite dimensional manifold, right? I mean, this is all now just flavor. But the question is, say you have now your infinite dimensional manifold of shapes. How do you measure distance in this shape space? And so what all of these pictures suggest, so I start with a shape here, and I'm searching for the lowest cost way of transforming, say, this horse shape into, a cat shape. I think this is also from Michio's paper, so they apparently like cats, right? So the idea is, so I have my infinite dimension manifold, and the shape, so this 3D shape is now a point on an infinite dimensional manifold. So when I want to compare two points, two shapes, I have two points on my infinite dimension manifold. And the idea is now I want to find the shortest connection between those two. So I draw a curve on my infinite dimensional manifold, and every point on this curve is one of those shapes. And that's what has happened here. So basically, they constructed a curve on this infinite dimensional manifold of shapes. At every fixed time, the image or the image point on the curve is one of these shapes. And so you see basically this shape of a horse morphing to the shape of a cat, right? And so this is the shortest curve on this infinite dimensional manifold. So if you know a little bit of Riemannian geometry, then the shortest curves have a nice name, so they are called geodesics. If you don't know this, so we will define what is a geodesic and how do you define and construct them. But the point is, if you have a manifold, then curves of shortest length require you an additional structure to make sense. And this is a so-called Riemannian metric. So Riemannian metrics allow you to compute these, or depending on the Riemannian metric, you get a different concept of what a shortest connection is in this shape space. And so this is the game of why you study in shape analysis Riemannian metrics and their geodesics on infinite dimensional manifold. But okay, so now I'm claiming
Alexander?
Everything. Yes,
Alexander. Yeah, just wondering, when you say infinite dimensional here, should I be thinking of something that is countably infinite or uncountably infinite?
Usually, it will be quite bad, sort of. If you so it will be so when I talk about infinite dimensional manifold, basically I pull out all the stops, so they won't be separable. In general, though, I must admit that at least in this example, you will have a nice fresh space, which in this case is separable. Yeah. So I mean, this is a little bit more special because of the application. Yes. Okay, but so basically, I, So I'm claiming that, that this is something infinite dimensional. You want to understand as infinite dimensional. And let me play a little bit devil's advocate. And let's look at a neat little trick which the computer scientists like to do, and which well, on first sight makes us a little bit questionable of what I'm just claiming, that this is something you need to understand as an infinite dimensional phenomenon, right? So basically, now we are getting a little bit more mathematical. So as my shape space where I didn't quotient out anything, so as we said, we are interested in the image of the curve, not of the curve itself. And so here this space P, those are all the smooth curves starting at a unit interval with values in two-dimensional space, right? So if I take a point in this vector space P, this will be a curve and not directly a shape. So that's also the reason why this this space is now called P. In the literature, this is often called the pre-shape space. So we didn't get rid of the parametrization of the curve. So this so elements in P also get the have the parametrization. Okay, and now we want to find shortest path in our pre-shape space P. So let's be very simple at the moment. Let's not talk about reparametrization invariance or something. Let's just think of, we have these curves and we now want to find the shortest path. And what we want to find there is we want to find a curve which takes values in my space P. Yeah, so in this pre-shaped space. So we are talking, so the C will then be a curve of curves, right? So if I fix C of T, I get something which eats points in the unit interval and spits out then elements in R2. So at every for every time point T, C of T gives me a curve. Okay. So C is now a curve of curves. However, when I look at this, or when you look into the parentheses on the right-hand side, so you see, well, you have C of T and then you evaluate in an X. Well, okay, this looks not like a curve of curves, but this looks actually like something which is a function of two variables, right? So I can do a trick which the computer scientists like to call currying. So instead of looking at C, which is a map taking real values into this pre-shape space P, I can just curry it if you want, if you like this this notation, and then I associate to it a function of two variables, right? So and what it does, it takes a time t and point x from 0, 1, and it just evaluates it. So instead of looking at curves in this pre-shape space, I can just instead look at a function of two variables, and everything here is finite dimensional, right? So the reals are finite dimensional, the interval is finite dimensional, R2 is finite dimensional, nothing infinite dimensional anymore, right? And we can, of course, ask ourselves, well, okay, in this finite dimensional picture, how do we find the shortest distance between two curves? Okay, so let's do a tiny little example. So let's assume this slide is R2, and let me just draw two curves, right? So, well, if I could draw, so this is just the curve, which is a straight line, and the arrow should just tell you where you traverse it. So this is C1 of 0, C1 of 1. So going from the upper part to the lower part, you're basically traversing this curve, and this guy here is C2 of 0 and C2 of 1. Okay, and now we're basically asking ourselves, okay, what is the shortest way of going from one curve to the other? And basically, I've chosen a super simple example. So since we see that we only have translated the one curve from the left a bit to the right, and I mean, and a sensible way of how would you get from the left curve to the right curve is basically, okay, I want to interpolate between those two things. So I introduce another time parameter. And at time zero, I just go the straight way from C1 of zero to C2 of zero. Well, I mean, that's perhaps a thing which one could try. And at any other point, so if I have C1 of t, over here we have C2 of t, then I just use the straight line. Okay, just think of yourself that I just drawn a straight line and just connect them. So this is certainly the shortest distance between those points. And I can do this for every point on these two curves. So I just connect them by a straight line. And what you see, I mean, this is now a very suggestive picture. So I basically get some area here between those two things. And the whole upshot was, if I compute the area between those two things, this should give me a measure of how long. So we wanted to find a shortest curve from C1 to C2 in the space C infinity 0, 1 with values in R2. And so if this shortest curve is called C, then we said, okay, associate to this a curve C wedge. And this is now something of two variables, eating reals and elements in 0 to 1, spits out something in R2. So basically what we get when we take here always a straight line, so we can think of it when we sort of look at this as having also the green one as having a time parameter. So we have the blue parameter. This is x coming from the interval from 0 to 1, and we have now an additional green parameter. This is going from left to right. Yeah, I mean, I'm doing here an extremely simple example. So from left to right is done by using here the green parameter, and from up to down is taking the blue parameter. And basically, what we can think of is the following idea. So we define the length of C in the space C infinity from 0, 1 to R2 as the area of this square. This is now sort of a very easy example where this actually works, right? So I'm cheating here a little bit. If you have more complicated shapes, you probably want to be a bit more careful on how you set this. However, this idea of going from the infinite dimensional pre-shaped space of smooth curves to a finite dimensional problem, this gives rise to a Riemannian metric on the infinite dimensional space, and this metric is the so-called L2 metric on C infinity from 0, 1 to R2. So what this actually means, if you want to compute the area, you're basically computing you're basically computing integrals, right? And so the L2 metric, as the name suggests, is you're basically computing some sort of integral to measure the distance, and you can show that this gives you a Riemannian metric on the infinite dimensional space. So okay, everything fine. This is an easy idea. We can do this. Now we get this L2 metric. Great. So we don't need all of this infinite dimensional manifold stuff. So what's all the fuss about? I mean, why is this guy insisting that this is an infinite dimensional problem? Okay.
Alexander, can I ask a question?
Sure.
In this example, it seems that we have just the one choose, yes?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
Thank yeah, I mean, this is a super simple toy example, which is oversimplifying the whole problem. Yeah, so as I said, what I've been doing the whole time. So we've been working with these C infinity functions from an interval with values in R2, right? So this is carrying a parametrization, and I said shapes are, we don't care about the parametrization, right? We want this to be independent of the parametrization. So this space C infinity, which I'm working on here, this space, which we called P for pre-shape space, this is not the right space. So what you want to do is you want to quotient out all the possible ways you can reparametrize these curves. Okay, you say, well, we started off well enough, so we have this L2 metric now on pre-shape space. If we want to quotient out stuff, well, maybe we can just quotient out the reparameterizations and are done. We get a nice Riemannian metric on the actual shape space. So if we want to make everything invariant under reparameterization, we have to quotient out the diffeomorphism group, diff plus. This turns out to be an infinite dimension Lie group. If you don't know what an infinite dimension Lie group is, I will tell you in a few slides. But what I mean by that, so this diff plus are all the smooth diffeomorphisms from the interval to itself, which do not change the orientation. So 0 is going to 0, 1 is going to 1, and so the diffeomorphism is basically doing anything. You can basically think of this as a time shift, if you want, right? Which fixes the endpoints of your interval. So you're not allowed to exchange 0 with 1, right? That would be the full diffeomorphism group you have there, but I want only the ones which fix the endpoints. So we are not time reversing the curves, right? Okay, and formally, if you have a metric, you have a group, you can just try the following. So you basically go to you have your group acting on the curves by reparametrization, and you just see whether you can make your metric invariant on the equivalence classes you get by reparametrization. And so here comes the kicker of why it makes sense to study infinite dimensional geometry. So the surprising thing which happens is the following theorem, which is not that easy to prove, but and I think it surprised many people when it came up. So there's a theorem by Micho and Mumford. And this is the geodesic distance. So recall we measure the distance between two points by taking shortest curves. And if you think of flat space, then basically you take the straight line. This is the shortest curve between two points. And if the points are not equal, the distance between those two things is always larger than 0. So the distance does not vanish. And and you get the same behavior if you compute geodesics on a finite dimensional manifold. So if you take a finite dimensional manifold and compute the distance using shortest curves, you always get a nice metric. So this gives you always, if points are different, then they have a positive distance. So this is what we expect when we have different things. The distance should distinguish between different things, right? However, exactly for this idea where we take this L2 metric, I mean, the one where we measure the area and quotient out the reparameterizations, what Micho and Mumford could show is if you compute shortest curves for this metric on the infinite dimensional manifold, then the distance is vanishing identically. So you cannot distinguish any points on your shape space by using an equivariant version of the L2 metric, meaning a version which doesn't see reparametrization. So that's simply not possible to make this work. This is too simple in a way. Okay. And basically, I take this as an excuse to say, it's worthwhile to study infinite dimensional Riemannian geometry. So you have this new phenomenon of vanishing distance. And this is really annoying to people who want to compute distances in shape analysis, because it tells you that the nice L2 metric, where you compute an integral to get your metric and your distance, this doesn't work. Right. So this and this was is really surprising. And In case you know Riemannian metrics, just look at the paper of Micho and Mumford. It's a beautiful construction, which shows, I mean, they even have graphic examples, but to explain them would take a little bit longer. Okay.
Alexander?
Yes?
So are you talking about given two curves, you take the infimum over all possible pairs of parameterizations of the,
yes,
the two curves?
Okay. Exactly. That would be the equivariant version of the L2.
Exactly. And it actually, you can attain the infimum, or you can just...
No. So with these vanishing geodesic distance, the point is every given curve you have there will have a positive length, right? So that's something you can compute. But vanishing geodesic distance means between two points there is an arbitrary short connection. Yeah, so you can always, for every, say, epsilon bigger than zero, you can find a curve connecting these two things, which is of length smaller than epsilon is. And this is a purely infinite dimensional phenomenon. So you cannot have that in finite dimensions. Okay. The other reason why you might be interested in infinite dimensional Riemannian geometry is curvature. So if you haven't seen what curvature means, basically there's an instructive picture, which I stole from a lecture on cosmology. So physicists made this picture. So there are basically three cases of qualitatively different curvature. I'm oversimplifying again because all of these things are, curvature can change from point to point. But so if you have positive curvature, you can think of basically thinking of living on top of a sphere, which is sort of curving on into itself. So that's positive curvature. And for negative curvature, you have the saddle point picture. And then there's flat curvature or flat space. So actually, it should be flat space, which just looks like the usual Euclidean space where you don't have any curved things. And so if you know Riemannian geometry, then you know that to every Riemannian metric, at least in finite dimensions, you can attach a curvature tensor, which describes how the curvature depends at every point on your Riemannian metric. Okay, why is this interesting? And why would you want to study curvature in infinite dimensions? So I have to warn you, also the next slide features a picture which I stole from physicists, and they have sometimes strange humor. Okay, so you have been warned, so meet Space Slug. So Space Slug is sitting on top of your space-time, and it's basically showing off to one thing. So Space Slug is basically shooting two lasers from its Space Slug laser gun, which are supposed to be completely parallel. And what's happening with the parallel lines, which are emanating from these laser guns, depends on curvature. So if you have a flat space, then the parallel lines, they stay parallel and they stay the same distance. So they are basically going off to infinity, staying parallel to each other, which is sort of what you learn in Euclidean geometry in school. Whereas what's typically happening when you are in positive curvature, okay, I mean, this slug is now standing on the on a positively curved manifold, which is a sphere. So it's actually coming back here. But also what the picture should tell you, so the two parallel rays are starting, and then they will be typically moving closer to each other. Whereas in the negative curvature, they are typically getting further apart from each other when you're starting with the with these parallel lines. Okay, and this is true for, or, well, you can make this mathematically exact what you mean by getting further apart and closer together, depending on what your curvature is. But this is also what is typically happening when you start with these curves of shortest length, so the geodesics. So you're starting somewhere and you just vary a little bit of how your curve of shortest length looks. And what will typically be happening if you have negative curvature, then even if your two lines of shortest distance, which are going almost in the same direction but not quite, in negative curvature, what will happen, they will move away from each other, so they get further and further away. In positive curvature, they would typically go towards each other if they are very similar in the beginning. And in flat space, usually nothing of this happens. Okay, but why is this interesting? Well, so in negatively curved space, as I said, these diverge usually exponentially fast from each other. And so this is now related to a discovery by Vladimir Arnold. So there's so he has a theorem which says for a metric on the volume preserving diffeomorphisms of a torus, most of the curvature is negative. Again, I'm very fishy here with what I mean by that. So actually, so there are some requirements on the metric. And what I mean by most is also not quantified. But if you look into the paper by Arnold, I mean, Arnold is exact. So he's if you read the paper, then he will tell you what that means. Okay. However, the interesting upshot of this is, so you have some equations which go into the usual weather models. So if you want to do weather prediction, say on the surface of the Earth, you want, so my wife is always annoyed when there's a weather prediction, it's totally off. And especially as you might know, so there's no accurate weather prediction more than a few days ahead. And so this theorem by Arnold that this volume preserving diffeomorphisms have mostly negative curvature, this you can abbreviate this as the mathematical reason of why there cannot be an accurate weather forecast to a very long time scale, okay, depending on what you want with a very long time scale. So the whole point is the equations which are going into the weather forecast, you can interpret them as geodesic equations on this infinite dimensional group diff mu of T. So you might wonder now, so T stands for the torus. And the last time we checked, the Earth doesn't look like a donut, right? So it's a sphere. Well, it looks more like a sphere. It doesn't have a hole in the middle. So I'm citing here Arnold's original work where he assumed that everything was a torus. It has been later generalized, so it's not necessary to assume that that the Earth looks like a torus, right? So you can have a sphere there, for example. So this was inessential. Anyway.
Yeah, I think it's fun that you bring up this example. I was really thinking about this example before you did bring it up. So if your course can give some insight on this type of problems, I would be really motivated to follow it, yes.
Well, I can't promise that we really get into the details. But so the whole point is, since, as I said, when you have negative curvature, sort of geodesics tend to diverge exponentially from each other, since we have never can have complete knowledge of the initial conditions where we are starting. Even if you have a tiny error in your initial conditions, this will get over time exponentially bad. And since most of the curvature is negative on these manifolds, if you have if you have some tiny errors in your computations, this will get bad very fast, sort of. And this has this was circulated in the media often as sort of the mathematical proof of the impossibility of an accurate weather forecast. Actually, it just describes that you need a lot of very accurate information to push the weather forecast beyond a few days and still stay reasonably accurate. Let's put it like this. Okay, so we will see this discovery of Arnold in another example. I mean, the weather forecast is probably sort of the most spectacular example you can have there. Of why you should be interested in Riemannian geometry on infinite dimensional groups and manifolds, because it relates to somehow to things which you see in the real world, and it lets you mathematically describe things which are hard to describe otherwise, at least with other theories or without a lot more of machinery. Okay, now I want to go to a second example. So this was mostly around, the first examples were mostly bundled together by, we were using Riemannian geometry in some interesting way. And the second example, or the second class of examples, will also use Riemannian geometry, but it's something of a different beast. It's basically from partial differential equations to infinite dimensions. So let's start with the heat equation. So the usual problem, we do it on the circle. So we think of a round metal band, which is hotter on one side And so heat will propagate through the metal, and after some time as it elapses, basically the heat will be equally distributed over the whole circle. So mathematically speaking, the circle is of course infinitely thin, but I'm just sort of exaggerating this here and draw as a torus to see sort of the heat distribution. And what you learn in basic courses on partial differential equations, the equations governing how the heat distribution will develop over the circle can be described by the following equations. So we are searching for a vector field called U. This is a vector field this is a time-dependent vector field, so it's a mapping of two variables. So it takes a time variable from 0 to infinity somewhere, and it takes the spatial variable from S1. And then you have this partial differential equation, the heat equation, so you have the time derivative of U should be equal to the second spatial derivative of U for all the points you have there. So this is the equation, and then you have some initial distribution where you start. Okay, so this is the heat equation, it's a partial differential equation. And now, when we think back of the first examples, so we, in the shape space world, we started with a curve of curves. So a curve which takes values in this infinite dimensional manifold of smooth mappings. And what we did, we said, okay, this is not really infinite dimension. We can associate to it a mapping of two variables, right? So we were going from infinite dimensions to just two variables. And now we have something here which is actually a function of two variables. Let's just play the game the other way around. So let's, instead of looking at this U as a function of two variables, let's look at this as a function which takes a time variable into a manifold of smooth maps. Okay, so instead of the U, we can, which is this function of two variables, we can look at the UV, which should be something which takes time points and spits out smooth functions. So we are just doing the reverse operation of this currying operation. So we're going to the infinite dimensional space now. And perhaps we can think of this partial differential equation, so of this heat equation, as an equation on the infinite dimensional space. I'm cheating here very heavily, because usually when you do partial differential equations, you're not thinking of solutions which are smooth, or not in general. Yeah? So you want perhaps solutions which have low regularity or are at most two times differentiable or something like this. But let's not get bogged down with all these technicalities. Let's pretend that everything here is smooth, right? Just for argument's sake. Okay, so instead of a function of two variables, we have now something smooth. Some function which goes into a space of functions again. And so here are some facts which you will know after the course. So the C infinity functions from S1 to R, they form an infinite dimensional vector space. And we can define a linear map which goes from the C infinity function to the C infinity function and sends a function just to its spatial derivative. So this is a linear map. And putting some nice topology on the smooth functions, you can even show that this operator D is continuous. Okay, and now we can just rewrite with the help of the UV the original heat equation. So the original heat equation was time derivative U is the second spatial derivative of U, or should equal it. And on the infinite dimensional manifold, this gives us a linear differential equation. So we can think of the du dt just as the time derivative of the uv. And then the equation reads the time derivative of the uv should be the same as we have to apply two times the operator d, which is a linear map, to the uv. And this should give the same as the second spatial derivative of the u, and then we do this neat little trick where instead of looking at it as a mapping of two functions, we look at it as a mapping into this function space. Okay, so at least if this, if all of this works as I claim, yeah, I mean, so long this I'm just claiming that all of this works neatly out, there seems to be a way of how you can rewrite this heat equation, which is a partial differential equation, as a linear differential equation, but on an infinite dimensional manifold, or in this case, an infinite dimensional vector space. So the questions which should immediately come to mind is, can this actually be justified? Yeah? So, I mean, I just claim that, well, you have this equation, and then we do this neat little operation with the V. I mean, it's not even clear. So you start with your mapping U, and to take a differential of the of this associated mapping UV. So the question is, of course, what do I actually mean by this differential here? And what does it mean to differentiate this curve UV? Because it takes values in some potentially horrible infinite dimensional vector space, right? So at the moment, all I've said, this is some sort of infinite dimensional vector space. It might be that we get lucky and this is, could perhaps be some sort of Banach space, and then we probably know how to compute derivatives and what it means for this thing to be differentiable. But if one looks closer, one will find out that this space C infinity from the circle with values in the reals is not even a Banach space. So it's more general space than that. So, and this will also be part of the lecture to define what do you mean actually by differentiability between these infinite dimensional spaces, and can you justify actually this rewriting procedure going from a partial differential equation to a linear differential equation, but then on an infinite dimensional space? Because I mean, if that's possible, and you can go back and forth between those two things, so possibly a partial differential equation, I mean, not this heat equation, but in general, are partial differential equations hard to treat? So it's hard to figure out solutions for them. But linear differential equations, well, I mean, they are usually much nicer. So it's usually much easier to solve them. So perhaps this is also true in infinite dimensions. Perhaps one can leverage this to learn something about partial differential equations. At least one can dream. Okay. And now let's do a bit more of an involved example. Going back to what I said about Arnold, so you can of course do this with more involved partial differential equations. For example, you look at the flow of say, for example, the surface of the oceans. So there's a nice picture here from a paper by Krizan, Flandoli, and Holm, which do actually a stochastic version of this. But basically what all these colors are, so people had dropped buoys into the ocean and tracked them via GPS over some time, and they want a model of the surface flow in the oceans of the Earth. And this is governed by something called Euler's equation, or at least you can model it using Euler's equation for an inviscous fluid. If you haven't seen it, well, there is some sort of partial differential equation. So you need a time derivative, you need some spatial derivatives in a complicated way. If you know Euler's equation, you probably recognize this. And so this is one of the classical equations which were first treated using this neat little trick by Arnold. So we are again searching for a vector field UT. The T is not does not stand for a time derivative. It just signifies that the vector field depends on time. And instead of searching for such a vector field solution to your equation, you can switch your viewpoint. You can instead of the vector field, it's equivalent to search for a flow of the vector field, right? So this would be the integral curve of the vector field. So a mapping eta, which satisfies UT of eta of T, is the same as eta dot. Right, so the time derivative of eta, that would be the Lagrangian point of view. And basically when you do this, you switch your point of view from the Eulerian viewpoint to the Lagrangian viewpoint, what you can prove, and this is sort of Arnold's discovery, which funnels directly into this statement about the weather forecast, which I told you. So I'm, if you don't digest the details right now, bear with me for a moment. So we have a whole semester time of getting to some of the details. And so this slide has some of the details behind what Arnold has been doing with weather forecasts, or why they are related to these infinite dimensional manifolds. So what you can prove is, if you look at the flow of the vector at the eta, what you can show is that they are orthogonal in some way to the divergence free vector fields. And what this means, so if you don't know divergence free vector fields, if you don't know what it means to be L2 orthogonal problem, the upshot of this whole construction is that the eta is a geodesic on the infinite dimensional manifold, right? And this is exactly what we also saw in the weather forecast. So the solution of Euler's equation can be related to a curve of shortest distance on some sort of infinite dimensional manifold. And this is the upshot of this whole construction. And well, then the idea is geodesics, or these curves of shortest distance, can be described by using ordinary differential equations. And for ordinary differential equations, if you're asking, does the solution exist? Is it unique? You have the usual toolbox of ordinary differential equations. Again, I'm cheating here a little bit, because the infinite dimensional manifold on which you're working there, or at least on which I'm claiming that we're working here, this is not modeled on a Banach space. And depending on how your calculus has been, so this usual theory of ordinary differential equations, when do they have solutions, when is the solution unique, only works up to Banach spaces or manifolds modeled on Banach spaces. Because, okay. And what I claim is that this diffeomorphism group we have here of the volume preserving diffeomorphisms cannot be modeled on a Banach space. So this is a nice idea, but to make this rigorously work so that you can actually reap the benefits of this whole machinery of rewriting PDEs as ordinary differential equations, but on an infinite dimension manifold, you have to work hard, and there are lots of technical details. Huh? So we are certainly not discussing the technical details of this in the lecture, because we don't have time for this. But sort of the dream, or why these things are related, is sort of relatively straightforward if one knows geometric mechanics. But to make things then work out, one has to invest also heavily in some techniques. Okay, now we have already seen a lot of things which I claim of groups, and also this word Lie group appeared several times during the talk, and I was promising that I give you a definition later on. And what I want to get at a nice little theorem which explains why, when you do infinite dimensional geometry, it's a bad idea to restrict yourself to Banach spaces. So this will be sort of the last piece of examples. So first of all, if you haven't seen it, what is a Lie group? So we encountered several infinite dimensional groups, and they were all sort of the same kind. So we had these diffeomorphisms diff plus, which were fixing the endpoints of the interval. We had diffeomorphisms of a compact manifold. We had volume preserving diffeomorphisms of a compact manifold. If you haven't noticed them, they were on some slides, and I was sort of glossing over the details, right? All of these groups are groups with respect to the composition of mappings, right? So if you have a diffeomorphism, which is an invertible maps, which map of from the manifold to itself, which is smooth, and the inverse is also smooth, so you can just compose them, you get again an invertible map which is smooth with a smooth inverse. So this is the group structure. And what I claim is they can be made into Lie groups. Question is, if you haven't seen, what the heck is a Lie group? And okay. Oh, what happened now? Ah, yes, okay. Sorry. Okay, now it should work again. Right. So a Lie group is basically a group. Okay, we understand groups, which is also simultaneously a manifold, such that the manifold structure turns the group operation into smooth maps. Okay, that's the definition. And now why is there this big blank space? So this would be the usual definition in finite dimensional differential geometry. You say, okay, we define finite dimensional manifolds. We define what it means to be for a mapping to be smooth between finite dimensional manifolds. And then we can look at finite dimensional Lie groups. Well, infinite dimensional Lie group, you basically take the same definition, but you allow instead as model space for your infinite dimensional group now infinite dimensional spaces of some kind. And then obviously you have to explain to me when you do this, how do you define differentiability between these infinite dimensional spaces? This will also be part of the lecture. So we'll, but the definition is a Lie group is a group which is a manifold such that the group operations is smooth. And we only in infinite dimensions, we have to explain what we mean by smoothness. Right, because we are working beyond Banach spaces. Okay, but let's get to the reason. So at the last slide, I claimed that this group of volume-preserving diffeomorphisms, that this cannot be modeled on a Banach space. So why is that? I mean, didn't we just, perhaps we didn't try hard enough, right? So the people who were constructing these Lie group structures didn't find the right structure. Okay. And let's talk a little bit about an action of the diffeomorphism group. So there's a very natural action, which means you have a nicely behaved mapping, which is somehow compatible with the group structure. We haven't seen group actions before, which is called the natural action of the diffeomorphism. So you take a diffeomorphism and a point in your underlying manifold K, and you just evaluate the diffeomorphism. This gives you a group action. So the diffeomorphisms act on the underlying manifold just by you take a point and you apply your diffeomorphism and look where you end up. So this is a group action for the diffeomorphisms. And so this action has many nice properties. So it's one of the properties, it's effective. This means if you have two diffeomorphisms and for every point in your manifold, the image of the point under one diffeomorphism equals the image under the other, then obviously the two diffeomorphisms need to be the same. So you can detect which diffeomorphisms are acting by looking at what they are doing on the points, right? This is what we mean by effective. This is relatively straightforward once one thinks of it. And the second property, which is not straightforward to prove, so this is actually something you have to prove. So this action is transitive. What this means is if I take arbitrary two points in your manifold, you can always find a diffeomorphism mapping one of the points to the other. Again, I'm cheating here a little bit. This is true for connected manifolds. Yeah? So in case you're wondering, it can produce disconnected manifolds. Well, this is not true. But as I said, we don't want to get bogged down with details. So bear with me for a moment. So this is so this just means we can go from one point to the other by choosing an appropriate element of this diffeomorphism group. Okay, and so the upshot is now the following. So there's a theorem by Omori. I forgot. So any natural Lie group structure on the diffeomorphism should turn this action into a smooth map. And if this manifold structure on the diffeomorphism group does this, we'll say we get a smooth Lie group action, right? Okay, and now comes the theorem by Omori from 87. So if you have a connected Banach Lie group, meaning the Lie group is modeled as a manifold, this manifold is modeled on Banach spaces. That's a Banach Lie group. If this Lie group acts effectively and transitively and smoothly on a compact manifold, then the group itself must be a finite dimensional Lie group. And looking at these diffeomorphisms, so if you could make the diffeomorphism group into a Banach Lie group, then the diffeomorphism group would be a finite dimensional Lie group. And one can do now a sanity check. This cannot be true. So if you think of this transitivity operation, basically for every pair of points on your manifold, you can find a diffeomorphism going from one to the other. So this seems to be highly unlikely that you can find a finite dimensional family to do this for an arbitrary manifold, right? So this is now not a hard proof, but if you think of it, what the diffeomorphism should model, it it will appear very soon that it's absurd that there should be a finite dimension manifold. So what Omori's theorem basically tells us is there's a choice. Either we can model the diffeomorphism groups on a Banach space, but then they cannot be a Lie group because this action will always be there. And so for all nice manifold structures, we would hope that the diffeomorphisms act smoothly on the underlying manifold. Or we have to model them as a Lie group, but then we cannot use Banach spaces. So this is basically the choice in Omori's theorem. So you can turn the diffeomorphism group into an infinite dimension Lie group, but not on a Banach space. Okay. This is basically concluding sort of the examples I prepared on applications or what new stuff is happening in infinite dimensional geometry, which you should care about or which I think people should care about. Let me just compile a list of problems which we will most certainly encounter during the course. What new challenges arise when you pass from finite dimensional geometry to infinite dimensional geometry? And okay, so the first problem is directly related to the last examples we were talking about. So Banach spaces are not enough. So we have often for interesting examples or natural structures, we have to go beyond the realm of Banach spaces. So we need to explain what we actually mean by calculus. So the very first chapter of the lecture will consist in me explaining what we actually mean by, well, first derivatives of curves, and then of mappings living on infinite dimensional spaces. And since the derivative of a curve is defined, if it exists, as a limit of this differential quotient, what you certainly need is, so the vector space we want to be studying on which we define calculus need a topology such that the vector space operations become continuous with respect to this topology. This is the so-called concept is topological vector spaces, right? So this calculus needs topological vector spaces at a bare minimum just to make sense of all to make sense of the limits of the differential quotients. Okay, but we will look at this in the lecture. Second problem, which appears in infinite dimensional spaces, we don't have compactness available for arguments, or usually we don't have compactness available for arguments. So what is happening in finite dimensions, or lots of arguments in differential geometry work like this. So you take a nice little ball around zero, take the closure, and this is compact, right? And then you do something on your compact ball, and because continuous functions are bounded in compact balls, nothing horrible is happening, so it cannot explode. So you work on your nice compact ball, and then afterwards you patch together compact balls and do a globalization argument. However, there's a theorem. If you have a topological vector space, so the things we saw on the last slide where you have a vector space plus topology such that vector space operations get continuous, and you have a compact set such that the compact set has interior points, then your topological vector space is necessarily finite dimensional. So this is something which is very well known. So you already face this problem when you're working in Hilbert spaces or Banach spaces. This is nothing new when you go to infinite dimensions, but on occasion it can be very annoying because sort of the usual compactness arguments are not available. So compact sets in infinite dimensions are very thin. I mean, there are compact sets, points are still compact, but so we can't use compact neighborhoods to do something in geometry. And this is often a problem. Okay. Why is this 4? So 3 is missing. Okay. So then the third problem it should be is the topology is ambiguous. So if you have a finite dimensional space, there's up to homeomorphism just one topology turning the vector space operations into continuous maps. And so this is, if you have a finite dimensional space, it's the usual norm topology you have there. And in infinite dimensions, this is no longer true. And this has some interesting consequences for infinite dimensional differential geometry. So this leads to the existence of weak Riemannian metrics. If you don't know what a Riemannian metric is, or you don't know what a weak Riemannian metric is, this will be part of the course. right? So we will talk about these new concepts and what happens if you have to weaken some notions from finite dimensional theory to do something in infinite dimensional theory. Okay, so there were two. And I was already talking about local to global arguments. In finite dimensional differential geometry, you often take smooth bump functions and patch, so you build locally something. You use a smooth bump function to just transplant it and to just let it go to zero outside of your bump. And it turns out that in infinite dimensional geometry, this is often problematic. There are even Banach spaces which don't have smooth bump functions. With a bump function, I mean a smooth function which on a given open set is constant equal to one. And on a and outside of a larger open set, which contains the one where, on which you want your bump function to be one, where the function should be zero outside. Huh? So the picture is then from finite dimensional ones is so you have a bump function. If you draw the graph. So here you have the u, and so here we have the v, and then I basically have at height one, I have this, and somehow it descends in a smooth way until it's zero, at least when it at the latest when it reaches the boundary of the U, right? And so there are Banach spaces which don't admit such smooth bump functions. So in general, we cannot assume that there are any nice partitions of unity or smooth cutoff functions. So all these patching constructions, which you might know from finite dimensional differential geometry, they don't work in general. I mean, they don't even work in general in Banach spaces. So one has to work around these things. Okay.
Sorry, just a question, Bob. Yeah? So these Banach spaces, are they very like ad hoc? Or, I mean, like say you have a nice Hilbert, separable Hilbert space or something like this.
In Hilbert,
would this fact still be true or?
Meta theorem in Hilbert spaces, you always have smooth bump functions. So this is okay. Hilbert spaces are not a problem. So this is a Banach phenomenon.
Okay. But so, are they very synthetic Banach spaces, or are they really, I mean, like LP spaces or solvable spaces or something?
Let me just think. So I think there are relatively natural examples of Banach spaces where you don't have smooth bump functions. You can push the limit of these things. You can construct Banach spaces which do not even admit bump functions which are C1. And if I remember correctly, these become a little bit more artificial. So if you want more information on this, the book by Kriegel and Michor, The Convenient Setting of Global Analysis. So they have a huge dedicated section which is going through criteria and examples of when these bump functions exist, and what happen or how you construct Banach spaces which don't have these bump function. For a lot of the function spaces, say for example, you're working with smooth functions and probably also with CK functions and so forth. If you consider them as infinite dimensional vector spaces, then you can prove that they actually admit enough good bump functions, right? So for the spaces you are interested, or I imagine you are interested, I think this will often not be the case, but then you need a dedicated proof for this. The upshot is basically there are some very ugly Banach spaces out there.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, right. So basically my takeaway message for today is this infinite dimensional differential geometry is useful for a lot of applications. So we've seen something from PDE theory, computer vision and shape analysis. However, there are new challenges. And so we saw this list of problems. I mean, these are on a surface level, these are the ones into which you run immediately when you try to just generalize, okay, I know finite dimensional. So there's something in the chat following up on Thurstein's question. So if you take the continuous functions on the interval with values in the reals, then they don't admit smooth bump functions. So this is, but I think you can. I'm not entirely sure what's up with the continuous functions, whether you can have CK ones. Then you can always do continuous bump functions. That's true. But if you that shouldn't be a problem, at least not on Banach spaces. And then it will depend on your manifold, whether you have something like paracompactness, whether it transmits to a manifold. But sort of the space is responsible whether your bump functions can be smooth. Okay, so we have all these new challenges, and what we'll do in the lecture, so this is sort of a plan of what I'm planning to do. So first of all, we need to do calculus beyond Banach spaces. We'll look at in which way can you generalize the differentiability beyond these Banach spaces. We'll settle on one and provide a nice calculus. This will allow us to study manifolds of differentiable mappings. So for example, like these C infinity functions on an interval with values, say in a manifold or in a vector space. And in this chapter will also allow us to make rigorous these neat little tricks which I had there, where we were going from the PDE to a linear ODE. And because it will explain in which way differentiability of curves, say going into this manifold of differentiable mappings, is related to differentiability of a function of several variables. So you can make this explicit and prove a hard theorem of when it works and when it doesn't work. So it doesn't always work, but there are some conditions under which these techniques work. Then we'll look into what are infinite dimension Lie groups and what are examples. So a class of examples which we didn't have in the talk today were loop groups and current groups. We will in this chapter construct these current groups. They usually appear in theoretical physics, but also have other uses. Especially the loop groups were quite popular when it came to, I think this was probably somehow related to quantum field theory and these things. Okay, and finally, we'll discuss weak Riemannian geometry, and we'll look closer at this L2 metric, which I didn't define today. So we will define it and then look at its properties. This was the offender when you make it equivariant by quotienting out the diffeomorphism group, which is vanishing, right? And so basically, we'll look at some phenomena of these weak Riemannian metric and what it means to have a weak Riemannian metric, and how this is separated from the finite dimensional case. I mean, we also do some finite dimensional stuff to have some reference points of comparison. Okay, and that was it. So thanks for the attention. And